didn't it? I bet. Hello, everyone. Welcome. How is your Halifax VegFest going so far? Yeah, pretty good, pretty good. Okay, next question. What have you gotten for food yet? Yell it out. Jamaican patties, awesome. What else? Ice cream. I love it. What else have you gotten? Okay, where? Curry, delicious. Guys, there are like so many good food vendors here. Please go. I just had like an unreal chana masala. So good. Everybody, go. Next question. How many people have you met so far today? Good. That's fine. We still have a few hours, guys. You can meet as many people as you can in the next few hours. But I'm encouraging you to, if you haven't gotten the memo yet, my challenge for you today is to meet as many people as you can and ask them three questions when you see them. One, what is your name? Two, what are your pronouns? And three, what is your favorite vegetable? So please ask those questions. Has anybody done that yet and got a response on a favorite vegetable? Yell it out. Asparagus. Awesome. I had one person meet somebody else. Good job. Thank you. Everybody go. I really encourage you to do that. This is the whole reason we're here and in person is to meet each other and meet this community. Okay. Now, let's start with the whole reason that we are here right now, which is we are doing this incredible panel discussion. We have members from animal sanctuaries around the Maritimes. Let's go through them. So we have three local animal sanctuaries, and we're going to have a panel discussion on what it's like running a farm animal sanctuary here in the Maritimes. Very first, we have Jen. Jen's pronouns are she, her, and she is the founder of Lalo Farm Sanctuary in Lower Canard? Canard, I'm so sorry. I'm not from here. I'm so sorry. She has felt connected to animals her whole life and stopped eating meat at 14 years of age when she first heard the term vegetarian. She has since become vegan since 2006. Jen has a degree in biology, did a couple of years of vet school, and has worked in many animal-related jobs. She... Thank you. Sorry, I slipped. I had to go to the next page. I'm going to keep doing her bio and then clap again. Okay. She got involved in animal rescue in 2003 while living in South Korea. Cool, Jen. Later, while living in New Zealand. Where are you going? Later, while living in New Zealand, Jen ran a farm animal rescue where in 2 years she helped over 100 animals. In 2018, she moved back to Nova Scotia to permanently settle, and she started Lalo Farm Sanctuary. Huge round of applause to Jen from Lalo. Yeah! Jen, thank you so much. Up next, we have Missa. Missa's pronouns are she, they, and Missa is a co-creator of the Wallflower Collective, a nonprofit, queer-run, trauma-informed interspecies community established in New Brunswick in 2017. Going vegan at 16, Missa has been a longtime animal rights and social justice activist, centering on interspecies friendship and collaborative care while abolishing systems of oppression. After a visit to Farm Sanctuary in 2011, they were inspired to build a space where non-human animals escaping exploitation could live out their lives in freedom alongside humans in a framework of community care. The Wallflower Collective is home to 8 big pigs, 17 small pigs, 2 goats, 3 sheep, 2 geese, 10 chickens, a turkey, and 5 humans, including Emily Pache. Thank you. Emily and Missa. And Emily's pronouns are she, her. And last, but certainly not least, we have Tim Clancy. Tim Clancy is an ethical vegan and co-founder of Lily's Place Animal Sanctuary, located in New Brunswick. There, he and his spouse, Jamie, care for 7 different species of animal residents. Tim enjoys spending time with the animals at Lily's Place, as well as working on infrastructure projects and repairs. Tim is passionate about elevating the status of farmed animals through education and by challenging common societal perceptions. Tim loves telling the stories of the animal residents at Lily's Place. Be sure to stop by their booth and ask him about Sid, Betty, Tardy, Daisy, and friends. Huge round of applause for Tim Clancy. That's wonderful. Thank you, all four of you, for coming from three different animal sanctuaries. That is so impressive. Thank you for coming. How this is going to work is I have a bunch of questions. I'm going to say one of them, and whoever wants to answer, go for it. That's pretty easy, right? And if you're not answering, then I will call upon you. So please answer. Sorry, I just spat over there. You saw that. Cool. I love it. Very first question. Tell us a little bit about your sanctuary. Just tell us, you know, where is it? What kind of animals do you have? How big is it? Anything like that. Who would like to start us off?
I'll start us off.
Oh, we need a microphone turned up on the very end here.
Hello, testing.
Yeah. Perfect. Okay. Yeah, testing. That was good.
Yeah. I'm Jen, and I run Lalo Farm Sanctuary. We're located about an hour and 15 minutes from Halifax in Lower Kennard. It's about 15 minutes from Wolfville in the valley. We have 5.5 acres, and we are home to 26 permanent residents, including 2 cows, well, they're steers, 2 sheep, 9 pigs, 5 goats, 6 hens, a turkey, and a duck.
Wow. So not many, then.
Not many. We also currently have 2 pigs in our care right now that are part of our rescue and rehoming program.
Wow, that's wonderful. I love that. And Lalo, what does that stand for, Jen?
Lalo stands for loving animals is loving ourselves.
Aw, all together. Aw.
Thank you.
Cute. Very sweet, very sweet. Who else would like to go next? Where is your sanctuary? What is it? Tell us all about it.
Oh, us?
Yeah, you guys go.
I'm Missa from Wallflower Collective. We are on 55 acres just outside of, well, we're in Weirs Beach, just outside of Minto, New Brunswick. I think I put in my bio the kind of animals we have and the numbers that we have, but what I didn't include was our urban hub. So Emily can speak a little bit about the urban hub. Where we also care for 8 pigs.
So on the urban side of things, which is kind of what we're calling ourselves, we live up in the Spryfield area, and we have 8 rescue pigs of our own. We have Eric and Bonnie, Gavin, Clover, Hedwig, Ponyo, Katara, and Cora. So we do a lot of rescues, and we end up having to bring them home, usually for rehabilitation purposes. We even did a rescue this morning. We had to drive out to Windsor to pick up a pig that had been in a highly neglected situation. So we rescue pigs that are in bad situations, and we try and give them the best quality of life, no matter what that means going forward.
That is so lovely. Thank you so much. Tim, tell us all about your sanctuary. Where is it? What do you have? Everything like that.
Okay. Well, we are in Cody's, New Brunswick. We're in between Fredericton and Moncton. We have about 25 animals. We are on 80 acres. And we're currently working on adding an 8th species. We're working with Cedar Row Farm Sanctuary in Ontario, who's trying to have a farmer release a dwarf cow. So exciting things are happening.
It sounds like exciting things. Yeah. Thank you guys so much. Okay, my very next question, and we seem to go this way for this answering, so maybe this next answering, let's go the other way. And my next question is, tell us, how did you get started in the first place? What year, what led you to do it? Anything like that you'd like to tell us about your startup?
Sure. We got started in 2019. My wife, Jamie, and I were always, dog people, animal people. When we met, we each had 3 dogs. So when we bunked up together, that was 6 dogs. So Jamie had always kind of volunteered and helped out at a few different farm sanctuaries and saw the need for more safe homes for farm animals. So we thought, you know, we have a bit of space. We started with 5 ex-battery hens, so ex-egg-laying hens. And then shortly after that, took in Sid the sheep. And of course, Sid needed a friend, so that was Betty, who ended up being pregnant when she came to us. Yeah, so, and that's kind of how we got our start. Once you get started, it's hard to say no to an animal, so the numbers just seem to climb. Yeah.
I love it, I bet. Now, can you answer the same question?
Do you want to answer first?
How in the world did you guys get started?
Well, I've been vegan since I was 16, and so the way that I've seen the world since that age has been caring for animals in a different way and seeing animals in the food system in a different way than most people people who eat meat see them. And I went to Farm Sanctuary for one of their hoedowns in 2011, where I realized that there was, like, a thing. Like, sanctuaries were, like, a thing, this place that I had dreamed of where you can build homes for safe homes for animals was already being done by really awesome people. So I did a lot of learning through the stuff that they put out. And then in 2017, we bought a 60-acre property in Weirs Beach and started with 5 hens and 2 potbelly pigs. And now we've got a lot of pigs. Now we specialize in pigs, and we've got a lot of pigs.
Quit bragging. We've got a lot of pigs. That was perfect. Thank you so much. Thank you. And Jen, can you tell us, how did you get started?
I've been working in animal rescue for a while. I mean, I really got involved with it in Korea when we lived there in 2003. We lived in a small town surrounded by dog meat farms, so in a way, like, animal agriculture there. And so we rescued 7 dogs while we were there and would rehome them with other foreigners living there. And we brought one back with us as well. And then I think after that, you know, when we came back to Canada, I really started exploring more animal rights stuff. And I watched a bunch of documentaries. One of them was Earthlings. And it really opened my eyes to veganism. And when I found out there was such thing as a farm sanctuary, like a place that you could rescue farm animals, I knew right away that's something that I wanted to do one day. Even while I did 2 years of vet school, my whole focus was, you know, then I could be the vet at the sanctuary that I'll have. I didn't ever think about working as a vet to make money, just to save money. And when we lived in New Zealand, I did get involved kind of by accident. We had a property and there was enough land, and we heard about these 3 little pigs that were orphaned and needed a place, and so we took them in. And then throughout the next 2 years, we took in a lot of animals and found really great homes for them once we got them healthy. When we moved back to Canada in 2018 with intention to permanently stay here and settle, we've got 3 children, it was time to stay put. We bought a property where we could do a sanctuary one day, but I wasn't sure at what point I wanted to get into it. Although I did join a bunch of farming Facebook groups was probably a problem, because I right away found out that these 6 goats were going to be euthanized because of a disease they had called CIE. So I said to my husband, I said, I know about CIE. I learned about it in a vet school. It's not a death sentence. Let's help these goats. And so we quickly converted an old falling down shed into a barn. And that's how we started here. We've since moved properties. We've got a bigger barn and a lot more animals now. But that's really what started Lalo Farm Sanctuary, with those goats.
Wow, that was an incredible story, all 3 of you. Thank you, thank you. I have another question. I'm going to have so many. That's kind of the point of this. But my next question, where do all these animals come from? Whoever would like to answer, can you tell us a little bit more about the rescue process?
Sure. I do a lot of this firsthand for both. I've done it for both Lalo and for Wallflower, where we go and we relocate pigs. sometimes we're reached out to by others who are concerned if someone in their neighborhood maybe has a pig that's being neglected, or maybe they know someone who knows someone. A lot of it is contacting these people and trying to convince them that it's in their best interest to give us their pet, preferably for free. And most people do not want to do this. It's a big ask for some. So it's a very difficult thing that we have to do. We have to try and convince people to part with their pets. And then we go into people's homes, their barns, and into their personal lives, and we take their pigs and we bring them with us wherever they need to go. So some pigs we are bringing up to Jen at Lalo. She has a pig right now that we brought up, how long ago? A month ago? Lenny, and we even found out that Lenny was our pig's biological brother. So the rehoming, it happens so often, and it's so quick. People don't really think about it, but we've been contacted about 6 different pigs just within the past month and a half. So people are very quick to get a cute piglet, and then they're very remiss to keep a 300-pound pig that they did not anticipate. So it's a lot of that. And we relocate pigs up to Jen, we relocate pigs up to Wallflower or wherever, and sometimes they get rehomed. And sometimes, like with myself, we get a lot of foster fails. So we have 8 pigs in our house right now, and they are all foster fails pretty much. You get attached very easily. It gets out of hand really quickly. but we go in, we try and be as kind as we can with these people, try and maintain some kind of relationship with them in case they ever need to reach out to us again in the future. And then as quickly and calmly as possible, we relocate the animal into the car with us, and then we take them to wherever their next step is. Yeah.
That's perfect. Thank you for explaining that to us. Does anybody else have anything to add to that?
Yeah, we get contacted by a lot of people. I guess people Google, you know, farm animal rescue or sanctuaries. So we get contacted by people, you know, if they're wanting to rehome a pig. For instance, Lenny, who Emily was talking about, his person reached out to us, and that was a tricky situation, you know, where, his life was at risk if he didn't get a placement soon. So we took him in. We get other people will let us know if they hear of an animal that's in a bad situation, like Emily was saying, and we'll try our best to try to secure that animal. So very similar kind of to what Emily said.
Wow. Well, what I didn't realize, Emily, you made a very good point that you kind of, as sanctuaries, you guys like are in contact with each other and helping each other out. Can you talk a little bit more about that community? Anybody who would like to answer?
I mean, I've worked with both these sanctuaries to help place animals. Both Wallflower and Lily's Place have taken animals where I've heard, you know, that they needed help. And as sanctuaries, we can only help so many. Like, we have to have the financial means, we have to have the volunteer capacity to be able to take the animals in. So we have limits. And sometimes if we can't say yes, somebody else can. And so it's really important to work together and to support each other, because we're all doing this for the same reason, which is to improve the lives of farm animals and help as many as we can.
Yeah, we have a common goal, so it's a lot easier to come together when you have a common goal. Ultimately, if one of us can't take a sanctuary or can't take a pig, the only option is to check with someone else. So we do try and maintain good relationships with each other, but also with the people that we rescue pigs from, because if we sever ties with people who have multiple pets, we run the risk that they'll not reach out to us again in the future if they ever have any other future rehomings. So we have to play nice with everybody.
Yeah.
And it works in our favor.
Great. Okay, another question. This one I would love for all three of you to answer, but no pressure. I would love to know what is a very challenging thing about owning and running a sanctuary, and then also what is your favorite thing about owning or operating a sanctuary? So please, what is the most complicated or the most challenging thing, and then what is your favorite thing? Whoever would like to start first.
I can go first on this one. You're welcome. I guess there are a few things that are pretty challenging. So from the human perspective, I work full-time outside of off the farm, so I work in Fredericton. So working full-time to supplement the costs of animal care means that I'm stretched quite thin. Also, not being given the skills to build things, as in my family, women weren't taught how to do things like that, so I've had to teach myself how to build things to maintain the property, which is in part why the property needs its own manager for that, because I'm not good. I'm not good at it, but I will try, and that counts, I think. And I think the issue that everybody is having right now is money and people power. We ask a lot of people. We ask for time, and we ask for money a lot. I guess one of my favorite things is that Wallflower in the last year has moved away from the sanctuary model, and we're working more as a collective. And what that does is bring together multiple salaries, multiple incomes, and multiple people who have the same work ethic as we do and the same dreams and desires for the wellness.
But their own unique skills. So by doing this, we've also collected a whole bunch of unique skill sets. New artists, all kinds of things. So it benefits us all in more ways than just financially. It's becoming quite successful in other ways too, which is exciting to see. Yeah.
Awesome. Anyone else?
Yeah.
Do you want to go again?
Sure.
Yeah, same question.
Yeah, well, exactly what Missa said. Finding the time. We work as well. And funding is always an issue. A challenge also is seeing an animal sick or injured. We do our best, but inevitably things like that happen. And then the challenge of finding appropriate vet care for farm animals is frustrating. Typically, the vets that do see them are used to seeing them as a commodity, right? Just like a farmer would. They're typically used to working with farmers. So. We sometimes have to kick and scream and fight to try to get basic vet care for the animals.
Yeah, I would just add as well that really if I think about the main challenge of running a sanctuary, the main challenge is money. I mean, if we have money, we can have time. We can have employees. We can have buildings, we can have people driving animals to PEI, to the vet college, if they need a special care. I really think that money is the main thing for farm sanctuaries. Farm animals are really expensive and their care is, it's just a big challenge financially. The best part, I think you asked about, kind of the most rewarding part, I think, is just the connection with the animals. I mean, spending time with these beautiful beings is incredible. I mean, I've been moved to tears almost when I'm just connecting with one of our sheep, Mary, for example. Or the other day, I couldn't find one of my morning chore volunteers, and I was looking in the field for her. And I was a little bit worried because we had a wasp nest that I didn't tell her about. It was actually like a bald-faced hornet nest, and they're pretty aggressive. And so I was thinking, oh, she's up in the woods. Like, I've got to tell her about this nest. And I went up, and I found Amy lying down at the back of our property with one of our pigs. And it just made me so happy. I mean, that connection is something so special. And I think that 100% that's the most rewarding part, is to be part of these animals' lives and see how they can touch people and, help them.
That was beautifully said, Jen. Absolutely
Thank
beautiful.
You.
Thank you. I think you brought up a very good point, though. One of you did. Maybe all three of you brought up good points. I'm sorry. I mean that but there's one in particular, which was that oftentimes we see these animals as commodities. So how can we, as the public, how can we kind of shift our thinking of animals and thinking of them not as a commodity, not as food, but, as our friends, as our... Like, how could we do that as the public? Do you see that happening at all, that change?
I think that it starts with going to places like Lalo, visiting places like Wallflower, and getting to know an animal on a level that you might not have experienced before. I can honestly say the first time that I sat face-to-face with a 150-pound pig, I was damn near peeing my pants. It's very intimidating, and I sat there for an hour determined to be his friend. That was all I wanted. That was all he wanted. He wanted me comfortable in his space. I wanted him comfortable in my space. And now Eric, my little man, he's my best friend. I'm his mama. We connect. It's about taking the time to intentionally connect with these animals and the people that matter to them. We are an extension of them as they are an extension of us. So people who come into our home, if they don't respond to us in the way that our pets think they should, our pets sense that. So we try and have a sense of calm around them, excitement and happiness. It's their home. I think we need to take the time to get to know their personalities. And when we know them, it is so much easier to do right by them, because now I see their faces every time I see meat. And I'm not a strict vegetarian. I eat mostly vegetarian. But a lot of that just started from spending time with the animals that I was also consuming, and the juxtaposition between those two things was not lost on me for very long. And those bonds change you. They change your mind. They make you want to do something different.
And surely Emily will be vegan soon.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm well
on my way.
When
she starts living at Wallflower.
Yeah.
100%.
That's perfect. Well said. Thank you, thank you, thank you. This is kind of like this is a lighter on the side of things question. I understand you guys have a few different species at your sanctuaries. How do those species interact with each other? Like, do you find when you bring in a bunch of different kind of animals, like, do they mesh? Do they not mesh? Can you tell us about that? I have no idea.
Well, as a general rule at Wallflower, we don't segregate by species. Unless it's for the safety of people around, like Penelope Ann is one of our large pigs, and she will end your life if you're any shorter than 5'8". So she has to be with her friends in her area, but otherwise we encourage our friends to get to know each other, so they build friendships with the oddest friendships, you know, like Henry was on top of Homer, who's a goat, and Henry is a pig the other day, and they were just chasing each other and rolling on each other. And for the most part, I mean, pigs are ornery. They can be really particular about who they like, but they also really like the goats and sheep, at least the ones at Wallflower do.
Yeah, I think it's the same for us. We don't really segregate animals unless it's for the safety of that particular animal. But we have a 31-year-old horse, Tardy, who is bonded with two goats. And she just always has an eye on where her goats are and makes sure they're tucked in at night. And first thing Ted does in the morning when he comes out of his stall is run up to Tardy and kind of weave in between her legs and rub his back under her belly. And you know, sometimes when you bring a new species in, they kind of look like, what is that? That's different. But it generally doesn't take long for them to just accept the other species and understand that they're there for the same reasons.
Yeah, we have some species that live together. We used to have all of them kind of in the same pasture, but when we introduced one pig, Louie, he's the biggest of the pigs we have. We have mostly kind of smaller pigs, and we had two of our goats, Star and Moon, they lived peacefully with all the other pigs, but they decided that Louie was no good, and so they just would harass poor Louie, and their hackles would be up, and they'd walk sideways, and give him the odd little headbutt, and so we quickly realized, because Louie stopped backing down, he wanted to fight back and defend himself, that there was going to be an injury if we didn't keep them separated, so we did create a pig-only pasture. The benefit for us, too, because we're on a smaller acreage than the other two sanctuaries here, is that we can have one pasture, or the rest of the pastures, other than the pig pastures, don't have to get rooted constantly with pigs digging for grubs or dandelion roots or whatever they dig for all day. So now we actually have some pure grass, you know. But yeah, it just depends on the individual animals. I mean, we have one cow, Norman, and he came with two sheep, and I think they all came from the same place together, and I think he was only a baby when he went to that home, and so he kind of grew up with these two sheep, and it's really interesting to see, because he lives with another cow, George, and then the two sheep and the five goats. And Norman is definitely bonded with the sheep. And George, who was raised with the goats, is definitely bonded with the goats. And they all get along together, but George doesn't love the sheep eating from his hay, and Norman doesn't love the goats eating from his hay. So we have lots of piles of hay and lots of little dynamics going on there.
Thank you. I was just so curious, and I loved hearing all those stories. I don't know about you guys, but you're like picturing it in your head. You're like picturing this goat running around with it. Yeah, and it sounds so cute and so sweet. Thank you. I have a couple more questions, and then I will be opening up the floor to questions. So please start thinking about what you would like to ask. But until then, I have a couple more questions. One, where would you like to see the future of your sanctuary? Whoever would like to answer. Yeah, Jen, love it.
Okay.
Jen, love it.
I'm trying to give up. Well, I feel like the kid at class at school. Like, me.
I love it.
Yes, the future of Lalo. Well, you know, okay. You know, it's going to continue to grow, but we're kind of taking a little bit of a different direction right now in terms of trying to focus a lot on rescue rehoming. We have 26 permanent residents right now. Like I said, we only have 5.5 acres. We're aware of our limitations with size, with pasture space, with finances, with time, you know. So we are now looking, like, how can we keep helping animals, yet we can't keep saying yes to all of them to stay with us permanently. So we do network with other sanctuaries, and then we're also starting a rescue rehoming program. And that's kind of where we're going to be focusing a lot of our attention and our funds, trying to build another barn and another space for those animals. We get asked, like a lot of these sanctuaries, about pet pigs a lot. We have two more coming in the next couple weeks, and we've got two up for adoption right now. Well, one's actually going to his new home tomorrow. But that's going to be a lot of our focus. We'd also like to do like a yearly factory hen rescue rehome. So that, and then also we're going to be more open to visitors. That's something we've always wanted as part of our mission, is to connect people with the animals in our care. And so the animals that are our permanent residents are kind of like ambassadors for their species. So people can see, like, this is what a cow is, and this is, you know, he's this beautiful own person. And, you know, just really that connection and education. So it's kind of where we're headed.
Awesome. Excited for you. Anyone else? The future of your sanctuary.
We'll go this way.
Sure.
So like I was saying, in the last year, Wallflower went from being a sanctuary to a collective. And how we view that going forward is to have land that's available to people who need it. Basically. So there are five of us who will be living on the property in the spring. And with that group of people comes, as Emily said, a whole host of skills and talents and desires for that space. So we will always be bringing in pigs primarily. I don't think that'll ever stop for us, even though we would like to do a rescue and rehome. That's something that we have played with a little bit. But when you love pigs, it's very difficult to let them go to places you're not sure they'll stay forever, because 1 in 4 pigs stays with their family forever, and the other 3 are bounced from home to home to home. So our hope is to be more self-sustainable. We want to be able to garden to feed ourselves and garden to feed the animals. We're already doing a lot of reclaiming, so we do a lot of recycling with pallets and other discarded woods. We would like to, you know, be on solar power, living collectively, creating collectively, and supporting the animals. The more of us there caring for them, the better their lives will be. And that is one thing that they don't get a lot of when it's just a few people. We need people patting, talking to, rubbing bellies, singing, dancing at pigs all the time. So, I mean, that's a goal. Yeah, 24-hour dance party for the pigs at least once a month. Can be done. That could be done.
I think so.
Yeah.
And I think for myself, I've lived in the city for pretty much my whole life. So I'm going to be changing my lifestyle, and we're going to be uprooting our family to go and join Missa up in Fredericton, because we really believe that this is the future for ourselves and for so many others who can't afford to buy homes but want to do right by themselves and their neighbors and their animals. And I'm coming from a situation where I'm losing my job due to a disability. I can't work because I'm disabled, and so I needed to find a home, something that felt like a place I could live out the rest of my days without feeling like a burden. And I found that with these people and these animals, and these animals are there to support you in just numerous ways. And my goal upon being there with them is to be a full-time caregiver on the farm, and to grow it from kind of like a little bit of a business standpoint, sort of like what we're doing here today. I really think that the farm has a lot of potential in that regard as well. So to see what we can like create together is going to be very, very exciting. Yeah.
It sounds exciting.
Yeah.
So well said. Thank you. And Tim, where do you see the future of Lily's Place?
Much like the others, we want to grow. We have the space, but we need the community to help. As mentioned earlier, fundraising and volunteering. We're working on building a horse barn, separate for the horses, but the lumber's been sitting there all summer. The foundation's done, but I just haven't had the time to work on it. Same with expanding pastures. We have, 200 fence posts sitting there that need to go in, but between working, cleaning, maintaining everything, it's just a lot of work. So it's going to take time, but again, with help from the community, we can get there and hopefully save as many animals as we can.
That would be wonderful. That would be the goal. Okay, this is my very last question, and then I'm going to open up the questions to all of you. So start thinking. This is my very last question. It is a two-part question, though, and anybody can answer this. First part of the question is, what do you wish we, as the community, what do you wish that we knew when it comes to animal sanctuaries or animals or rescuing, anything like that? What do you wish that we, as the general public, knew about?
That mini pigs do not exist. Okay? Anybody that tells you that you're getting a mini pig, you are guaranteed to have a pig that could go up to 300 pounds. So a lot of the reason why we do as much as we do is because there is a huge misinformation about people breeding small pigs, and it's simply incorrect. The way that people are able to maintain these breeding styles of these very, very small, under 100-pound pigs is by underfeeding and then continually breeding underfed pigs. And that is how you end up with these mini pigs. So if somebody tells you that their pig is full-grown at 50 pounds, that is where the situation is coming from. However, what we see a lot is people giving misinformation, because even that 50-pound pig could grow for up to 5 years and become 300 pounds at any minute. And then those are the pigs that are being returned to us.
Just all of a sudden.
People need to know that pigs are permanent fixtures in your home. They value you like you value them. They are so incredibly intelligent, and they are big. They are a lot of work, and they are big, but they are very, very worth it. And I think people need to remember that, because the pig that we rehomed this morning was like 150 pounds, and people just don't think about it. But that's a big part of why we rehome pigs, is sheer size. Yeah.
Emily, thank you for saying that, because I honestly did not know that there was no such thing as mini pigs.
It's sort of like a sub-brand that they use to make it look cute and fun, yeah, or whatever, to make it appealable to people who live in the city. We live in the city and we do have pigs. It's totally possible. We know people who live in the city and have pigs. But you just have to consider them more as a child or a full-sized dog, not a cat, which is what people seem to be trying to sell them off.
Very good point. In case you didn't hear that, Emily said you have to think of pigs as either your child or a very, very large dog, not a cat.
So we're all on the same page. They're very toddler-like. So if you would like to own a toddler for 20 years, get a pig, and you will have so much fun. You will have a toddler from start to finish. I promise.
Yeah, sounds like a lot. Anybody else, what do you wish that we as the public knew about, whether it's animal sanctuaries, rescuing, anything at all?
Well, I think one thing that we've kind of touched on, but maybe a lot of people don't consider, is when we take in an animal, it's there for its natural life. So that could mean 20 years for a pig. That's 12 to 14 years for a sheep or a goat. It's not a short-term thing. Everybody loves to see new intakes and young animals being brought in, but we are caring for animals for their entire life. So as they age, typically that means, you know, more medications, higher expenses. So yeah, I think that's something that, you know, we don't always think about.
Yeah, I would 100% agree with Tim on that. It's, you know, when you're running a sanctuary, you're trying to keep your kind of followers and your supporters engaged, and you kind of have this feeling like you need to be taking more in and keeping it fresh. But it's like every animal we take in is a lifetime commitment, like Tim said. It is sleepless nights, you know, all sorts of things. It's just, running a sanctuary is so emotionally, financially, and time, like a time drain. It's a lot of work, and sometimes we have people that get upset that we can't help their roosters that they've hatched and they've fallen in love with, and, you know, that's hard because, you know, we do our best, and I do my best, certainly, when people phone me crying and upset that I can't take their roosters, you know, to support them and stuff, but it's a full-time thing, you know, you're never not running a sanctuary, so I guess I'd love for people to know that and understand that, and just support us all by kind of sharing what we do and talking to people and basically just... I don't really know what I'm saying. I'll just leave it at that.
No, that was awesome. Okay. Thank you, Jen. That was awesome. Okay. All of you, so well spoken. I learned so much. Thank you. Now, this is my second part of the two-parter question. What can we do? What do you need from us? How can we help? Is it money? Is it coming to volunteer? What, as the public and as people who love animals, what can we do for you?
All of those things.
Yeah. All, please.
Liking and sharing, like following us on social media, liking and sharing our posts, which will get your network connected to the work that we're doing. So then that generates more people who will give us money. And or we take building supplies and food donations. Like, we take a lot of other things. So we don't, not just money, but money is super important. Bodies, money, and your friends and family. Yeah. And your firstborn.
Yeah. Yeah. And your SID number and, yeah. Yeah. Like,
and credit, yeah, card number. Right. I know I was forgetting something.
No.
We also take, since we're getting close to Halloween, we are going to be collecting people's old pumpkins, since we're talking about it. Pigs love pumpkins. So if you have jack-o'-lanterns, pumpkins on display on your front porch that haven't been, I know some people put Vaseline or bleach or something in there to keep them fresh longer, but if you have just a fresh pumpkin or a fresh jack-o'-lantern, we're going to be collecting them, so I'm going to be posting about that on social media, so for sure check us out, because they do love the pumpkins, it's fantastic for them, and it's a really good way to reduce waste, so anytime anybody has any, like, waste that they want to get rid of, that is really helpful. We're always looking for drop apples or anything like that that we can have to supplement their nutrients. And kibble, we buy kibble, but it's just kibble. You know what I mean? We like to give them extras if we can. So that's helpful, yeah.
And I'd agree with what Missa was saying. You know, basically sharing our social media, yeah, pages, talking to people about what we do is really good, and then definitely financial support. So at Lalo, we've just got a new initiative right now, the 100 Friends of Lalo, and basically we're trying to create a fundraising community to take some of the pressure off of us just having to ask for funds all the time. So we're trying to get 100 people committed to raising $100. That can be through, like, selling stuff that you've got sitting around your house that you don't know what to do with, or talking to your friends and colleagues, seeing if they'll donate, and try to raise $100 for us by November 30th. And then we'll have a private fundraising kind of community on Facebook where you can chat about ideas and meet other people that are part of this community And then once a year, we'll host an appreciation day at the farm where we can get together, have some lovely vegan food. You can meet the animals you're helping and meet each other. So trying to kind of create fundraising in a community way, you know, like a...
I'll just add, I'm going to be a little more cheeky here, but I think stop supporting breeders. You know, I'm sure most of us here aren't supporting breeders, but friends and family, you know, if you see them supporting breeders, maybe have the discussion with them if you can, and let them know that, you know, so many of these animals end up homeless or the burden of somebody else. So whether that's dogs, cats, farm animals, anything, just please stop breeding.
Thank you for saying that. Yes, I completely agree. Always adopt, don't shop, always. What I love, guys, is that you gave us, each of you gave us some things that we can do that are very easy, as well like maybe putting more time in or actually coming. The thing that sounded like the easiest that we could all do, let's all do this right now, take out our phones. Let's take out our phones because this is the one way that we can support them that's absolutely free. So let's start with Instagram. What's our Instagram handles, everybody?
We're at the Wallflower Collective on Instagram and the Wallflower Sanctuary on Facebook.
Okay, so that for Wallflower, it's a Wallflower
Collective,
mm-hmm. on Instagram. Everybody look that up.
Look at everyone.
All right, and Jen, what's your Instagram?
Lalo Farm. So Lalo again is L-A-I-L-O, and then Farm. That's Instagram, and Facebook is Lalo Farm Sanctuary.
Wonderful. And do you have one for Lily's Place?
Yes, Lily's Place Animal Sanctuary.
Lily's Place Animal Sanctuary. Again, so that is like the fastest and like cheapest way to support these people and these sanctuaries. But also, you said donating, donating money especially, but also donating maybe some food waste or your pumpkins, going and spending time. Awesome. Thank you guys so much.
And we always need builders.
And you always need builders.
Sure. Yes. Skilled builders or handy people.
Okay, so guys, we could be doing so much. I love it. I will now open up the floor to questions, and all I'll need from you is if you could just raise your hand if you have a question, and I will get this. Oh, Jesse will take the microphone to you. Does anybody have a question for our panelists? Come on.
Hi there. I know none of you explicitly said it, but I'm sure you'd love people not to eat the animals that you care for. Do you have any encouraging tips about that?
If any animals that get adopted from sanctuaries, there are stipulations in the contracts that any animal before being rehomed is to be returned to the sanctuary, and under no circumstances are they to be sent for slaughter. It does happen that we are contacted about pigs that are going to be sent for slaughter if we do not pick them up, and they're generally potbelly pigs, which you wouldn't really eat anyway. People are just whatever. So no, we make sure that that is not a possibility for any of the pigs that are into our care as soon as they're in our care. Yeah.
And I would also say that there are a lot of really great vegan people doing work around vegan activism, vegan activists. So I think I don't feel like we need to put as much work into that specific aspect, even though, you know, I've been vegan a long time and obviously set the example through my friendships and things. And we are a vegan sanctuary, and we don't want our friends to be eaten either.
I'd like someone to speak about turkeys, because recently they've been eaten at Thanksgiving, they might be eaten at Christmas, and no one's talked about turkeys yet.
Well, I can definitely talk about turkeys. We love turkeys. Turkeys are incredible animals. Turkeys are social, they're curious, they're friendly often. We were just approached about a turkey and we took her in. Her name's Gertie. We took her in about a week before Thanksgiving. And Gertie is just pure love. I mean, this turkey, she will follow people around and just plunk herself down, and you can pet her for, I feel like you could pet her probably for hours, and she would just sit there closing her eyes and loving it. Our 7-year-old recently had a bit of a meltdown because we wouldn't let Gertie sleep inside with her overnight the other night, and she thought it was too cold for Gertie. So Sorry, Astrid. we had a group of school kids out last Thursday to do some volunteer work. They were high school girls, and one of them was terrified of birds. And so she saw Gertie. Gertie started walking over, and, you know, I wasn't sure, because Gertie's also very curious. She loves shiny things, and, you know, if you have fun clothes on, she might like those. But Gertie just plunked herself in the middle of this group of kids, lay down, and everyone started petting her. And by the end of that visit, that girl was saying, I need to adopt a turkey. I love turkeys. And so turkeys, yeah, I mean, turkeys are amazing.
Not a question, actually, but I just wanted to make a comment on my experience. And I went vegan 3 years ago when I was following a farm sanctuary from Alberta. It's the Alice Sanctuary. And she was, you know, describing these individuals. It was incredible for me to learn about them. And actually, I do hope to go visit her. Her sanctuary, the Alice Sanctuary. She's also called Plant-Based Farm Girl. And she actually named a pig after me, which I was thrilled. The pig's name is Edith. My name's Edie, but I guess Edith is more formal. So just so you know how important the work you do is, and that advocating for veganism is important through the sanctuaries.
I like that. Edith.
It's
a cute name.
Thank you.
Edith. That's my baby.
Thank you all so much. Those were great questions. Awesome. And thank you all so much for coming and for listening. Let's give a huge round of applause to our panelists. We have Jen from Lalo Farms.
Thank you.
We have Missa and Emily from Wallflower Collective. And we have Tim from Lily's Place. Thank you all so, so, so much for coming. We really, really appreciate you. I hope you all learned something and enjoyed yourselves. Please, I encourage you to go out, go see the vendors, get some food, and please, I'm dying for you to meet each other and ask those three questions that were so important. So go out and ask those three questions as much as you can. And as well, I'll tell you what else we have going on here today. There we go. At 2 o'clock, we are going to have our next workshop, which is, again, in the workshop room, which is in the lobby to the left of the ice cream. Make sure you get some ice cream. Our next workshop will be at 2 o'clock. The last 2.5 years have been a wild ride. Perhaps you need a recharge, but perhaps you're not sure how to get started. Learn 8 practical steps for feeling better and brighter. Natalie will be teaching us about wellness and self-care. Find her in the workshop room at 2 o'clock. Thank you all so much. I hope you're having a lovely day. My name is Kristyn. I will see you later. Okay, bye. Love you, bye.
Okay, bye. I like it. Informal.